Sean Van Niekerk, Head of IT and Cyber at Dartford NHS Hospital Trust. We're joined by Dr. Alex Graham, MD, Chief Operating Officer at the Ahmed Graham Group, and Dr. Saif Abed, MD, Director of Cybersecurity Advisory Services at the Ahmed Graham Group. Richard, you've assembled a stellar cast. Lovely to welcome you all. You have the floor to tell us about a healthcare MSS of the future.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I think during pandemic times, you know, healthcare has become front and center for all of us, right? We're all relying upon the brave doctors and nurses that are keeping many of us and our family members alive during these trying times. And it's somewhat disheartening to understand that healthcare is under concerted cyber attack by opportunistic cyber criminals, cyber organized crime, and nation states out to steal cures for COVID, right? One of the reasons why I assembled such a star-studded cast here today to discuss some of the issues that are impacting healthcare and to ask the questions, you know, where do we need to focus our attention and what does it make sense to try and perform internally versus with partners and providers in the space. But first, I'd like to go down the line, if I may, and have each of our panelists here today say a few words about themselves, what they do, and perhaps what keeps them up at night. Saif, you're first on my list here. Perhaps we could start with you, if that's okay. And you need to hit that mute button, by the way.
Gets everyone there you go. So yeah, so I'm Dr. Saif Abed. I am a NHS doctor by background, but I stopped clinical practice about a decade ago to help set up the Abed Graham Group, which is a global technology group that emphasizes and focuses on risk and security consulting in healthcare. We operate on both national security project levels and local level projects. And outside of that, I also work as an independent expert reviewer in healthcare and cybersecurity for the European Commission and a few other global government agencies.
Great, thank you. Thank you. Sean, you're next on my list. Perhaps you could say a few words.
Excellent. Firstly, good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for having me. I'm Sean Van Niekerk, so Head of IT and Cyber at Dartford and Gravesham NHS Trust. We're basically a local acute hospital based in Kent, England. My role, in essence, I lead a small but dynamic IT function while building a reputable cyber capability. This has sort of been ongoing for a while. I also have the pleasure of serving as the joint chair of our National NHS Cybersecurity Associates Network. This basically comprises about 1,000 members across the country, collectively securing a few, you know, million assets. So our greatest challenges at the moment, of course, is going to be holistic IT. And when I say holistic IT, I'm talking about specifically around stuff like leadership, you know, resourcing, and of course, balanced tooling. One of the big issues I sort of have at the moment. Something else, cloud transformation, and probably one of the biggest things as a result of COVID is the constant wizardry of producing, you know, security safety nets for this rapid digital transformation. This stuff keeps coming. And of course, you know, we need to pull rabbits out of hats to try and make this stuff work and to ensure that it remains secure. And that is, you know, that in itself is something that could just keep me busy for the next 10 years without having to pick up any other additional work.
Well, yes, I'm glad to see that you're being kept more than part-time occupied, sure. Anyway, you've got a nice long list of things on your plate there by the sounds of things. And finally, Alex, perhaps you could say a few words.
Yeah, absolutely. So very nice to meet everyone. Thanks for having us. My name is Alex Graham. Again, I'm also a clinical doctor. I work with SAFE at Arbor Graham. I'm the chief operating officer. So I'm basically in the background kind of doing all the stuff that SAFE wants to do front and center. Biggest challenges really for me, I suppose, is that marriage of healthcare and security and making sure that basically security solutions that we provide or we work with our partners are appropriate in the healthcare context. And that's the real key in terms of basically making sure that context is true as it goes for hospitals, you know, in the UK, but also globally. I think, yeah, that's something I'd like to touch on today. It'd be really interesting to discuss how the context within healthcare is key when we're looking at these things going forward.
Great, great. Thank you very much. So I wanted to start by coming back to something that Sean mentioned in his introduction talking about security resources. How is attracting and retaining top security talent in healthcare, which is in a highly competitive market? I mean, let's face it, healthcare. How do we attract and retain top of this, digital transformation and cloud adoption and IoT adoption that's taking place in healthcare, right the way through, and other technologies that are slowly working their way into even the British NHS? And you're on mute again, Sean.
Yep, 21st century problems, yeah. Yeah, so Rich, epic question. That's all I can say, for many reasons. And I suppose my response will be different from other industries or other sectors. So we need to slightly go back. I'll try and keep this brief. So the NHS has a different problem, as I said, and hopefully I will afford myself the opportunity to speak for the majority. So I guess seismic shifts in IT normally take years for technology teams and probably process, to evolve and align. The NHS has only really started its cyber journey probably around 2018. And this was probably the financial year after WannaCry unexpectedly announced itself. So remember when it happened in mid-2017, there weren't specific budgets to make this work. And even if there were, people wouldn't know what to do with that money. So it's taken a very, it's only been a short time now, a couple of years, 2 years at most. But from my point of view, the majority of the NHS, probably don't have a healthy balance between recruiting adequate cyber resources and, of course, cyber tooling investment. I think many organizations probably have underutilized tools, being a little bit top heavy, where you make a big investment and it just sits there, not getting the best out of it. So I would say a shortage of talent in the NHS is not probably the biggest issue in my opinion, but talented cyber leadership and the appropriately defined governance standards and staffing structures, I would say, is probably undoubtedly a key impediment that we're probably experiencing at this point. And I'll just give you an example here, just to sort of quantify what I'm saying. CISOs, which we all know are pivotal posts, I'm fortunate enough to have a lot of good CISO type contacts, in the UK, but also in the States. And I learn a ton from these people. And fundamentally, without that level of structure, especially in our world where we have this rapidly evolving risk, none of this stuff can be aggregated and assessed holistically across the NHS without that type of person being at the helm, driving that kind of change. And this is relevant to stuff like estates, medical physics, which you mentioned on, obviously medical devices, that sits within electrobiomedical engineering. We've got development teams that are, developing loads of internal apps, but again, don't fundamentally focus on security. And this extends to procurement, being the gatekeepers of, safe systems. And then finally, probably one of the key elements, which Dr. Graham and Dr. Abed would agree with, is patient safety. So as you can imagine, we need to take a step back in the sense of not just saying, oh, there's a shortage of staff. We need to agree the structures to have the staff and the right balance of staff in the first place. And it might sound, a little bit backwards in the sense that we don't have that yet. The NHS is still trying to find its feet. And a lot of good development, don't get me wrong, has happened in 2 years, but they're still trying to pinpoint, those key areas, key niches, both locally and nationally. So sorry for that long-worded speech there, but ultimately that's sort of the state of play in my opinion. And I engage with a lot of people to validate this level of thinking.
Yeah, and I think that's a very useful insights, quite frankly, Sean. I mean, healthcare is fundamentally different from other businesses and industry sectors because of the risk to patients, right? It comes down to patient safety, and we have an extremely complicated environment. It's not just securing IT, it's securing facilities and biomed and research and a whole heap of different facets of the industry using different types of equipment than you would find in a real estate business, for example, or financial services, to come back to my earlier example. Dr. Abed, tell us a little bit about what's going on from a digital transformation in healthcare and how that is complicating the security picture.
Yeah, I mean, healthcare has been going on a very interesting journey for, I'd say, the last two decades, where there is a fundamental mismatch between what I call digital maturity and security maturity. And when I say digital maturity, it's been this journey to move away from paper-based workflows to digital workflows. And you see a lot of incentivization in terms of regulations, laws, and policies in different countries to drive that. And as healthcare organizations have become gradually, at different paces, less paper-based, they create new risks, digitally-based risks. But there hasn't been the same level of security, cybersecurity investment in people, processes, technology, what have you, in order to address this flip side of the coin. But at the same time, with the advancement of digital maturity, the organizations that have achieved success with those digital workflows are now going for even more advanced digital workflows with a greater shift to cloud, analytics, automation, and a whole different suite of things, much more IoT adoption. So we're creating this fabric, this threat surface area where it's tied together through a drive towards interoperability as well. And so to have this smorgasbord or web of risk that different healthcare organizations don't necessarily have complete insight on. Governments don't have complete insight on the risks within what is effectively national critical infrastructure, if not regional critical infrastructure. So the way I view it is that this mismatch between digital maturity, which has moved at pace, that's lagged, that has security maturity lagging behind it, that gap, I call it the attacker's arbitrage, and that opportunity we've been seeing time and time again continues to be exploited. And now the attackers are becoming more sophisticated. They understand the concept of clinical urgency. If I can exploit a vulnerability with a threat model, a threat framework that is going to affect clinical services, I'm more likely to get the outcome I desire faster, whether that's pure disruption or getting a payout for a ransom. The sophistication is starting to creep into the attack space. So that's a whirlwind description of how I view the landscape right now, but it continues to move in that direction. And you know, I see it both in my more European type advisory role, as well as in the work we're doing extensively at the Arvid Graham Group.
Right, and I think that pace of change is accelerating, right? I mean, if we look at, you know, the digitalization of healthcare over the last 5 to 10 years, right? It was a steady, gradual buildup of moving from manila files to electronic medical records, and then the meaningful exchange of information between different provider groups, you know, across healthcare organizations. And now we've suddenly, you know, in the space of, you know, 6 weeks this year, moved or transitioned largely from a face-to-face patient consult environment to one that is essentially 90% telehealth today, right? And, you know, as we move back into the flu season, so, you know, doctors' offices are going to be, you know, more or less empty, I would imagine, if February and March were anything to go by.
Well, it's an interesting point, actually, what you raise around telehealth and telemedicine. This creates a completely different tangent of risk in terms of the security maturity of the supply chain. Because now you have lots of relatively small companies cropping up out of nowhere, getting some funding to deliver telehealth services very rapidly. And because of the clinical urgency of the pandemic to get these services online, is the governance being scrutinized of these companies? Is the security status? Who is supporting the CISOs on the healthcare provider side to do this work when there's this other pressure from the healthcare organization to get these digital services up and running? It's just an accelerated version of what we've been going through over the last two decades.
Right, right. And I want to bring in Dr. Graham here for this as well, but is there actually a fundamental mismatch in terms of the security that we're providing patients and healthcare IT today from what we really need? And I'm thinking in terms of, you know, what Dr. Abed and I were just talking about around telehealth, right? We've implemented a lot of systems pretty much overnight. We've said to hell with the, you know, the normal security governance and controls. Let's get this out so that we can see patients, so that we can help save lives and improve, you know, improve the well-being of the community. By their interactions with medical personnel, but is there a mismatch? Do we need to go back and clean things up? And if so, what is it going to take to get healthcare to where it needs to be?
I think that's probably correct. I think there probably is a mismatch, and what Sean and Saif have said is kind of responsible for that. The speed of change from the digitalization side of healthcare has been really rapid, and obviously the UK is now catching up to the US and a few other places. And perhaps the security element has been overlooked, not necessarily from a malicious standpoint, but from a resource standpoint. The paperless transition and EHRs have been such a burden for a lot of healthcare institutions that it's actually very difficult to have almost the bandwidth to concentrate on a lot of other things. So fundamentally, there will be, you know, as Saif mentioned, an outpacing from, you know, what is happening to the security standpoint of that. I think the other thing, just to mention, rather than everything being necessarily on the providers themselves, because they get a lot of flack for a lot of this sometimes, is actually from the vendor side of things, providing potential solutions for these areas. We've worked with vendors in a number of areas now in security for the best part of a decade. And really, vendors have struggled sometimes in a couple of ways, one in geography and two in verticals. Geography-wise, a lot of, you know, sometimes US companies come to other geographies, such as the UK or parts of Europe, and struggle because they lead with a US-centric resource set or template set or way of working. And actually, understanding the keys of basically the UK as a country from a geography, but also healthcare within the UK as an entity is key. And I think other vendors who are looking, potentially coming from other verticals and looking at healthcare as an option, they may have worked in, you know, aviation or local government, banking, finance, whatever. But actually knowing the local and national nuances of healthcare in a specific country, I feel is really key. So there's a mismatch, not necessarily just from the provider side, but also from the vendor side to get up to a specific level, so that everyone is on the same level playing field when it comes to an understanding of where we are, what is the kind of the ecosystem and the background of this specific healthcare system, what are its specific requirements, what are its specific workflows and policies, and really building all of the stakeholders involved in that around a sort of a common theme and a common goal. So there are a lot of work to be done, but I think if both providers and vendors and, you know, again, partners and people, third parties can sort of step up and close some of those gaps potentially, then in theory we'd be in a much better position.
Right. So yeah, I would agree with you. You know, healthcare is very unique as an industry, as I mentioned earlier, and it's also unique by the delivery models in each geography, right? Whether it's nation state geography or a regional aspect. So one size doesn't fit all, in other words, right? You can't simply switch off or isolate a device that may be rogue and chirping malware across your network laterally, because that device may be rendering care to a patient, right? And by isolating that device, you have put the patient at risk, you know, either of, you know, potential death, or a risk of not receiving the treatment that they may be in the middle of at the particular time. How do we understand, you know, or how do vendors begin to understand the nuances of healthcare, and what can we do to educate the vendors in the particular space about things like, you know, medical device security, which are growing at an exponential rate, as you well know, right? How do we convince vendors, you know, to understand, you know, the way that they need to operate in a healthcare environment? I'll open that to all three of you.
I mean, if I can take this one just briefly, whether it's the manufacturers of devices, whether it's the security suppliers, whether it's EMR vendors, whoever you may be considering, there's a fundamental cultural question here. Are they prepared to invest in understanding the nuances of a clinical workflow in a particular healthcare setting? If they are not willing to invest in understanding that, or to bring in a person who has that expertise, then everything else they're doing is paying lip service and it's purely marketing. There needs to be the ability to demonstrate, we want to understand this because we understand that the fundamental goal of our security solution, our medical device, whatever it is to improve patient outcomes at scale, or at the very least, not diminish them. Right. And that is the fundamental question culturally that must be addressed by any organization before we can even consider what are the ways to then do that, because there has to be the acceptance that we want to learn before we can then take on the resources to learn. That sounds like a real cliche, but it's a key issue.
Right. Sean, a few comments?
Yeah, absolutely agree. In actual fact, Dr. Bed, in my personal opinion, is one of the leaders in that level of consultancy around the supply chain, something that, you know, I've posted about, you know, fairly often on, you know, on LinkedIn, for example, you know, when I always use the two hashtags, resilient by design and secure by design, two things we believe in. You know, if they can understand that workflow, if they can ensure that those two hashtags, you know, are built into their culture when building the device and implementing the device and maintaining the device, guess what? You've got our attention, and you know, and those are the kind of suppliers that we want to work with and commit to.
Yeah, absolutely. And Dr. Graham?
Yes, I agree with that. I think any vendor that can show, kind of go that extra mile in terms of understanding the true context of what they're looking to do in whatever area will kind of jump out potentially from the pack. Obviously, as I said, both from a geographical standpoint, from a vertical standpoint, understanding that healthcare is different between other verticals, but also even within geographies. I mean, the NHS itself obviously has a rich tapestry of different organizations that all have different agendas, cultures, workforces, workflows, and indeed security profiles. So a workstation, you know, that may or may not need to be fixed or patched or whatever in terms of primary, secondary, community, tertiary care will be different. So at least having some idea of the context of your potential clients in terms of that is really important. And I think the questions you've asked so far in terms of just in terms of patient care as well as the confidentiality aspect of healthcare is really key. Obviously with confidentiality, integrity and availability attacks as those sort of the three broad ones. A lot of people focused on data breaches, specifically certainly in the US, because that's a big issue. But I think we really need to get to an understanding of what the INA can potentially do in terms of a patient, in terms of patient outcomes and organizational workflow impact.
Right, and I think you raise an interesting point there, and one that, you know, I've been soapboxing about for, you know, a number of years now, is that, you know, essentially confidentiality is lost, right? My data, my PHI, my PII has already been stolen four or five times over. It's on a dark web. It's on the dark web multiple times over. Do I really care whether it's stolen a fourth time or a fifth time, right? Are we devoting too many resources towards out-of-date regulations protecting the confidentiality of patient information when we really should be looking at the integrity of health information? What happens if my medical records are attacked, my allergies are removed from my medical file, and my blood type is changed, right? If there isn't time to cross-match me, what happens to me in a medical procedure if I'm given the wrong blood type or given the wrong drugs, right? That is more concern to me as a patient than whether my data is once again posted to the dark web. What happens in the case of, you know, another WannaCry or some type of other attack that impacts the availability of health IT and health IoT equipment, right? If those systems are not available for doctors to render care to patients or to review a patient's drug history or their treatment history, how can doctors effectively treat patients in an optimal manner in order to affect the best patient outcomes?
So I just want to quickly pick up on this for a number of reasons. Number one, the key issue here is scale. So I'm always the first person to raise my hand and say, we have to avoid fear, uncertainty, and death. This isn't homeland. Hackers, if you will, quote unquote, I dislike that phrase in a way, it's misused too much, aren't trying to assassinate individuals by hacking their pacemakers or remove specific allergy data. But what can happen, and I coined the phrase, I call it the clinical integrity extortion attack, is if we threaten to scramble data at scale. That is insidious. And actually, for a long time, it was something that I wrote about that was theoretical. But we've seen now, even last year, Ben Gurion University, they developed a type of malware that created fake cancer nodules on CT scans. And 97% of radiologists reported it. Because of course you would. If you see a cancer nodule, that you are going to report it, and then you may question, you have to rely on the clinical history. Does this make sense for this particular patient? But of course you're going to report it. So we're seeing that filter in research-wise, and it's a matter of time for causing widespread disruption or a new type of ransomware almost for this to filter through. In terms of just sheer availability, well, we've seen that time and time again now. Every day, every week, there is a health system somewhere that's under a ransomware attack, and you see the, you know, you see the response around that. And that's really interesting because I think healthcare providers have actually become a lot more sophisticated in, over the last 3-4 years in terms of how they deal with this, but it is highly, highly variable still. I think there is an element culturally of, well, you know, if it hasn't happened to my neighbors, it hasn't happened in my region, or I can't see any, you know, clear news from my regulators at a national level telling me to be worried about this, let's put it off and spend our money on the EHR system or whatever else it may be. But, you know, I just want to raise the point that this stuff, integrity attacks, obviously availability issues, this isn't just theory anymore. It's being worked on, it's emerging, and we have to determine how people like us on this panel and in the audience today, how can we work together to share best practice? Because not one of us has the right answer for everything. So we need to collaborate to figure out what's the best route forward.
Right. Sure, Richard, just on that. I think it's not just a case of either or. I don't think it's a case we've spent too much time thinking about confidentiality attacks and data breaches and forgotten about, you know, potential integrity and availability standpoint. I think it really needs to be both. The mantra, sort of oft-told mantra, is that confidentiality doesn't kill. And while directly to a degree that is the case, there is some evidence saying that actually responses to confidentiality attacks kind of go over the top and actually do lead to negative patient outcomes because of the security hoops that you have to jump through an institution. They compromise clinical workflows. So we do need to look at both, certainly. I think it's not necessarily a case of either or prioritization. It really needs to be, if best we can, all as much as possible.
Yeah, absolutely. I would agree with you. Sean, a few final words?
Yeah, I agree with both of you. One was focusing on one was focusing on both. I'm focusing on all three. Absolutely. Because obviously working, you know, at a local level, working with pathology department, working with the radiology department, you get to see this stuff, you know, in its full glory, you know, how it works. And, you know, I can tell you stories now of recent discoveries that will absolutely shock the masses. But that's the kind of conversation we cannot have publicly. But the reality is the game is changing. You know, things are getting pretty real. We spoke about, you know, digital transformation. Think about this just as one little quick little example. You know, me and my team, we get to architect, for example, what an EHR system will look like. And if I told you outright that it could be anywhere up to 22 virtual machines, you know, very complex services running across multiple platforms in different areas, put it this way, all the health records is sitting now in this. All the PDFs coming from ECGs is now sitting in the medical record. And so as we started this journey, that record is collectively going to grow over time, right? Whereas historically, they used to print that stuff, medical records, there's a ream of paper, there's your medical notes. That now is going to become a thing of the past in due course. Once that disappears, you know, and you have all hell break loose, cyber attack, you know, some sort of ransomware. We always speak about this, but there's a lot more that can go wrong, whether it's intentional or unintentional. The reality is there is no, you know, medical records library to go back to. You cannot go and fetch the physical notes. Guess what? The electronic system now no longer works. You know, and again, we spoke about, you know, the confidentiality as well. Think about it like this. Confidentiality breached, somebody sends stuff out. Think of the you know, the fines that you potentially get off the back of that. That affects your revenue. It affects your reputation. You know, the Care Quality Commission suddenly puts a spotlight on your organization. That's a nasty place to be. Most execs, most boards wouldn't want to be in that position. So again, to say that, you know, one supersedes the other. When we talk about patient care, absolutely integrity, but they all interdependent. That's just my view.
Yeah, I would agree. But at the end of the day, I would reiterate that, you know, what is most important to me as a healthcare cybersecurity professional is ensuring that patient care is not impacted, right? That patient safety does not become a byproduct of a lack of cybersecurity across the industry.
And I absolutely agree with you, because from my perspective, being, let's say, a patient in a hospital as well, I want to, you know, if my data went walkies, that probably would be less of a priority, more around the fact that I need to be treated in a timely manner. And if you're going to disrupt the system in my time of need, or how about this, the results coming from all the diagnostic tools filtering into medical systems that, you know, some of the diagnosis has been made off the back of that information. If that starts being manipulated with, how do you trust an entire healthcare ecosystem? You can't. So, you know, I think we've pretty much alluded to the fact that all three are pretty, pretty vital.
Yeah, and you, I wanted to harp on, you know, one point you made there about trust, right? I mean, healthcare is based upon trust in our doctors, trust in our clinical care team, and they are reliant upon trust in the information that they use in order to diagnose and treat us, right? And cybersecurity is all about maintaining trust in the IT systems that we are now heavily reliant upon.
Agreed.
Great. Well, I think we're just about out of time, Phelan. So I wanted to hand the gauntlet of the microphone back to you. And with that, thank my my three wonderful panelists here today, Dr. Saif Abed, Dr. Alex Graham, and Sean van Nijkerk. Thank you.
I'm glad you didn't call me doctor.
I always got about to call you doctor, but maybe a few more years in school might facilitate that, if that's an avenue you want to pursue.
Maybe a doctor in cybersecurity, yes.
Well, there you go. Great. Thank you very much, gentlemen, once again.
This is great. Yeah, thanks for all your time, and thanks very much for Richard for arranging this. And it's great to see Richard in native England.
Indeed.
You're now native Colorado. We had lots of comments actually going on, and it's difficult to pluck some things out. Some people wondered what's under the hood of the healthcare MSS of tomorrow. I think we touched on what it might need to do, and perhaps we don't quite have the ability now to go into the SaaS. Tim Staden was asking about, several years back there was a lot of development around logon and clinical workflow automation via CCOW and HL7. He gave everyone a case study about that, including cardiograms, and I think you can read that. Graham McGowan, he says, Saif, you have a LinkedIn message from me. So good, okay. Tim Staden agrees with you. What you're saying now, Richard, Sean, has been a problem historically with resistance to, for example, getting rid of generic workstations, turnkey A&E systems. Standard cyber thought processes don't always fit the use case. Very good. And we had Andrew Smith. Thank you, guys. Very informative. And Graham says, very relevant. Any comment on track and trace? But we can't go there because we are out of time. We're saved by the bell. I look forward to seeing you again very soon. Hopefully you could join our November healthcare event. We can talk about that later, though. Richard, Dr. Saif, Sean, and Dr. Graham, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Perfect. Well, thanks a lot. That's really exciting. We've been talking about elephants in the room a lot today, and healthcare is a big elephant in the room.